how much is required still to improve it, and how they are, how you know, the other higher fidelity model like large ID simulation or even direct numerical simulation, what are their limitations, and whether we should use it or not for practical applications. So the focus of this is primarily on the turbulence model. So I will take a couple of slides so that you have a complete idea about what it is historically. So what you see here, that as I said, you know, that the earlier work in turbulence modeling was done by Prantl and Karman, but his mixing length model is the one that is still actually you can use it in some cases, and you can get a reasonable answer. Okay, so if you have a unidirectional flow like flow over a wing, you can still get a really reasonable answer. And until actually 1980s, this is amazing, because of the lack of computer, 60 to 70 years later, these two models are also based on still the Prantl's mixing model. Because they are algebraic, no partial differential equation, nothing. Okay? So people did not know how to even solve the Navier-Stokes equations because without the computer, because so highly nonlinear. So that's why there was not much progress for about 50 to 60 years in the development of tolerance models. So it was like a, I would say, very minuscule progress. The good news was that even today, if you take any problem in which the flow is benign, not separated, primarily unidirectional, like a flying wing, you can get a very good answer. Not for the pressure you can get with the Euler solution, but even for the skin friction. Okay. Now, if you look at them, there is a 1985, this is called a half equation model. The reason it is called a half equation model is that it is an ordinary differential equation to define the eddy viscosity. So people somehow, I don't know why they call it, but that is the reason for half equation. Okay. So it, maybe it is half as difficult to solve as a PDE. And then this is the most well-known model. How many of you have heard of it? So it is in almost every code, not only ANSYS, but CFX, STAR CD, a console, you name a code and they have a SA model. So this is the most widely used model. It has a number of benefits. It is only one PDE to calculate the eddy viscosity. Okay. So turbulence modeling means that you have Reynolds average Navier-Stokes equation in which a stress is defined as a proportional to strain, and the proportionality constant is the eddy viscosity. In a laminar flow, the stress is proportional to strain, and the proportionality constant is the dynamic viscosity of a laminar fluid, which is exact, known from the kinetic theory of gases. So this is empiricism that comes into play. So you have stress is proportional to the strain with a proportionality constant being mu t or eddy viscosity. And how do you model it? It is modeled by the length scale primarily. In very few cases you can bring the turbulent time scale. So that is where this turbulence modeling comes in, to model the effect of turbulence. So people have been struggling for over 100 years how to model mu t for all kind of flows. So there is a recirculating flow like in this room, or you know, even without any compressibility effect or many other effects, it still is very difficult. Okay. So stress is proportional to the strain in a laminar flow. What is that law called? Newton's law is force is equal to mass times acceleration. Say it again, say loud. No. Newton, don't give him too much credit, he's already got too much. Newton's law is primarily F is equal to ma, and Navier-Stokes equation is nothing but the Newton's law. Okay, there's a momentum equation. So why you call Navier-Stokes rather than calling Newton's law? because stress is proportional to the strain with dynamic viscosity, is similar to the Hooke's law. In a solid mechanics, stress is proportional to the strain with the Young modulus as the proportionality constant. So this is called Stokes. Stokes discovered in. So stress is proportional for a lamp. They just plugged it into the Newton's law and enabled it. So, for eddy viscosity, for a turbulent case, the stress is proportional to the strain with proportionality constant being mu t instead of mu. And we don't know how to model it, and that is the whole subject for 100 years. What is that law called? What is the name in literature? The Boozer equation. Mr. Boozer is the one who suggested that stress should be proportional to the strain and proportionality constant be called mu t. And so people call it a Boozer approximation. But most of the people don't know, it's not important actually. That's not a critical thing, you know, to know these things, but it's just historical anecdotes, you know. But this is the model that is there in almost every code. Now in this model, this model works very beautifully in many of the cases, not all. But there is a parameter in this model, which is actually maybe in the later slides, which is a distance. Which means that the distance is, it is a factor of the distance from the wall. So this model works extremely well for the wall boundary. Distance is from the wall. Now, if you have a shear layer flow that you have, then you have a jet mixing with the external flow, then what is the distance? So that is where it doesn't work that well. So it has a limitation. Okay. So actually, in 2015, that is about 23 years later, one of my students and we developed a wall distance free model. So again, you can Google all that, or this is in the very good journal, you know, the AIWA journal, which is a very prestigious journal. So now you can use this model without worrying about the wall distance. So the advantage of that is that if you have a curved wall with a high curvature like an aerofoil or some even higher curvature, then you don't have to worry about how to measure that. So sometimes what happens is you create a grid and there's too much curvature and you don't know how to measure that distance. And that introduces some small error. Most of the time it works. But if you want to have a very rigorous derivation of a wall distance free model, then you can go to this paper. And this is a paper with my student called, his name is Rahman, he's in Finland. And so this is published 23 years later. Then another student of mine, which did a work which I'm going to emphasize, which I think is a very, very good one, equation model, and that is called the Ray Agarwal model, which is a one dimensional version or one equation version of the SST K omega model. But what it does is that SST K omega model has two equations, that is K equation and omega equation. So what we do is that we take the best features of K and best features of omega and merge into one equation. So it is a very creative model with a lot of thought. So if you look at it, at the bottom here it says there is a blending function which makes it possible to behave in near the wall as a K omega model and away from the wall in the free stream as a K epsilon model. And it is so powerful that it works at least as good as SST K omega model with half the cost. And then again, originally it was developed with a wall distance into the equation. But now we have a wall distance free model, which was actually just published last year. So this is a very slowly developing subject, because you cannot just sit down and make a change, because once you make a change, you have to validate everything, which means you have to at least make 20 to 30 more patients for it work. Process, you know, as if you are doing fundamental research. But the bottom line is, this is a very slowly developing subject. So then, you know, the same person who is now in Finland, so this Rehman, Agarwal, and Sikonen is actually a Finnish name. So after he worked with me, then he went back to work with Sikonen, you know, in Finland. Okay. Now this guy is from Bangladesh, by the way, right, our neighboring country. And so he created a model, and this was published in 2011, which is not based on SSTQ omega, but it's based on the original K epsilon model. Again, it has only one. Now they are all published in really very prestigious journals, and now if you ask me, all these you have, and most of them have been done by my group, which is the best? I should know this, right? So this is the best. Of course, since this is an old model and it is built into all these core CFX, Star CD, COMSOL, ANSYS, so still people are using this and they will continue to use it. But now we are trying to convince some of these companies to look at it. So they are looking at it, and actually I will show you the history of it, because it's only recent, and only 3-4 years old. It may take another 10 years once it becomes the part of many of these codes. But NASA has already put into their code, Boeing has put into the code, a lot of Chinese people have put in these codes, and its UDF is available if you want to put in the code. Okay. But you know, and like anything new in life, you know, people are suspicious, you know, they want to stick with the old way. All right. So, but a good technology will be a good technology, and it will find a way later on. Okay. Okay, now we will go. So having talked, the way I am showing you this, and this is a, all these slides are really very valuable, you know, if you have time to read it. So we started with zero equation. Then we went to half equation. Then we went to one equation. So these are all one equation models. And these are all on the web, actually. This is on NASA website. This is on the CFD online and some other website. And you can put in the Google and you will find all this. Now I go to the two equation model, which are all in almost all codes, which is K epsilon model. And there are various versions of them, you know, some modifications of all kinds. Based on the log approximation and so on. So there are a lot of them. Now this is the one which is also used in almost all the codes, SSTK omega, or shear stress transport model. Okay. And then if you have a transitional flow, then you have a four equation model. So in transitional flow, you have the K equation, you have the omega equation. And what are the two other equations? Has anybody used it, or maybe, yes sir? Yep. Excellent. So you have two more equations. One is the Re theta equation, that is the momentum thickness Reynolds number equation. And the fourth one is the intermittency gamma equation. So this is called KSST, K omega, Re theta, T gamma, all right, model. And it actually does a transitional flow. Perfect, but it does a good job. So what we did is, and since we have a Ray Agarwal model, with based on the SST, K omega model. So what we did is, that we took the equation SST, K omega model, and creatively reduce into two equation models. So one of them is the original Ray Agarwal model, combined it only with the intermittency equation. And it does as good as always this. So there is a lot of room to do a lot of creative work. But then you have to know the fundamental ideas and physics. You just cannot do by brute force. Okay. So you have to think about it, and then once you have some idea, then you have to implement it, and then you have to test it, and it's a painful process. Okay, but it is worth doing that. But then there are other models, which are various versions of it, based on the SSTQ omega model, but these are not transitional models. But they create more complications, and my feeling is that they are a part of actually the fluent, but the benefits are very minimal. And then they have the nonlinear and full Reynolds model. So you know how many quotients are there in the full Reynolds model? So there are 7 equations. Because it's a full matrix. So you have 3 diagonal terms and 4 side terms. And every shear stress term is there. And so if you have 7 equations, means you have too many constants to fix them. Okay? So there was actually long time ago, you know, long time ago. There was a student from Italy, you know, and he was sitting in the same office I was. And his job was to fix this full Reynolds stress model. And he tried to do it for a simple flat plate, for which the Prandtl mixing model gives an excellent answer. And after he spent 1 year as a postdoc, he could fluid mechanics forever. This is the truth. Okay, so that is a danger of doing turbulence modeling, you know. So, of course, there are stories that even people like Heisenberg gave up from that. So you guys are even braver than Heisenberg in a way. So anyway, these are very difficult models, but they have shown some improvement, but they're really not that great. So right now, what is the bottom line? Of course, one thing I will also want to tell you, that this SSTK omega model was developed by Mentor, Florian Mentor, who is in Germany. And he is now in charge of the entire turbulence modeling for Fluent. So he can put in any model he wants, actually. But some of them really work well. So right now, the best models are SA model and SSTK omega model, in some cases, the standard K epsilon model. And I think that unless until there is a need, you can stay away from the rest of them and get a reasonably good answer. Now, the newer models that are coming in, I think among all this, I mean, I am, you know, not, you know, here as a salesman, but I am telling you truthfully, is the Agarwal model has the best potential. And I think it will you will see the way in it in a matter of another 3 to 4 years. But there are other models that I mentioned. So this basically captures the history in 2 slides of all the models that are there in most of the codes. So now I told you the Spallard-Alamaz model. I'm not going to spend too much time. You can read in a book. There is a book by, trying to remember, Wilcox. Have anybody seen the book by Wilcox? What is the David Wilcox? It's not very expensive, actually, if you go on Amazon.com or some other, you know, website, and you can buy your old book, and it will not be, you know, I think more than 2,000-3,000 rupees. And so, but it is a really, even today, after I would say 30 years since it has been published, it remains the only best book in turbulence modeling, because there is no other book that has been written properly. So what you see here is, there is mu t. That is what we are after, right? Stress is proportional to the strain. So mu t is basically is a one equation that calculates it. All right? So this is already put in most of the codes. But you can do it yourself. Okay? Now I told you this d. This little, see this d, that is the distance on the wall. And so now we have developed a wall distance free model that works better for a shear layer flow. So there is an improvement to do that, but all these models are too many constants, 10 constants and 5 auxiliary functions. Okay, so my warning to you is, don't fiddle around with that. If you fiddle around with those constants, there is a possibility you can improve something. But then you will mess up something else. There, to fiddle around with 10 constants, 5 auxiliary functions is too many. So people have taken lot of time, lot of effort, and lot of test cases to fix them as much as possible. Okay? So even if you fiddle and you show I have done some improvement, I will never accept your paper. You show that improvement in 20 other cases. So be cautious about that. I'm just warning you in the practice. But if you show improvement in 20 other cases, I think it's worth looking at it. So this is the wall distance free model. And again, it has been published, you know, you can look at it. So in this case, what happens is that we modified, and if you see, this is the equation, which is similar to the previous equation, but there is no D. So there is no D, but it creates, you know, a little more thinking about it, how do you create that wall distance free. And this is the paper that has been published, and people have looked at it, and some people have taken some steps to implement it. But it is not in any of the codes, by the way. It is only 2 years old. Now, this is the one that we developed in 2011, and at that time we were very excited. And so what you have is the K over epsilon. So it's like K over epsilon model, but now both of them have been put together in the form of eddy viscosity. So K, what is the K over epsilon? What is K over epsilon? No. K over epsilon, I already said, is eddy viscosity. So if you write down the eddy viscosity, what is the definition of eddy viscosity in terms of units? It's K over epsilon, right? So if you write down mu T, it is C mu K square over epsilon. And what is C mu? It is almost a universal constant of 0.09. So this is nothing but the eddy viscosity. Okay. Now what is the eddy viscosity in K over in SST K omega? You know. So if this is the K epsilon model, so SST K omega model has K and omega. So what is the mu T? Some constant. Let us say some constant times what? Same units. Units have to be consistent. Okay? So what we are doing is, in every case we are trying to solve for eddy viscosity. Whatever be the model, one equation model, two equation model, 10 equation model, ultimate goal is to solve for mu T. So now there are some details. So you see that this is R, and so this is the eddy viscosity. So this is now one equation eddy viscosity model based on K over epsilon. So what it has done is, in a creative way, took the two equations, K and epsilon, and then calculating K separately, epsilon separately, and then calculating mu T from this equation. We have combined the two together by looking at those equations and creatively combining them. It requires a lot of actually thinking, and come up with this single equation for mu T, and it turns out that it works really very nice. May not be in all cases, but most of the cases. So that is the work that was done by this student of mine, and then he went to work for Sikonon. Okay. You know, by the way, all these people in Finland, they have the similar kind of last thing about their name, just like we have all these South Indian people. Venkat Raman, Valakrishnan, and so on. So they have Sikonon, Sepunan, and so on, you know. Really. And if you know, if you are interested, the 20% of the Finnish language is derived from Sanskrit. And in the Baltic countries, there are three countries: Estonia, Latvia, and there is another one I'm trying to remember. So there are three countries in Baltic countries, you know, which are across the channel from Finland and Sweden. Okay? Or Lithuania. So Lithuania, Estonia, and Latvia. They also have a very predominant language, a component of Sanskrit. And among them, Lithuanian is the one that has a maximum component of 30%. Okay? How did they happen? You know, there is a history behind it, migration of the people. But you know, Sanskrit is really, you know, has been around for a long time, and you should all be very proud of it. So Sekundana is a Finnish name, by the way. And most of them, as I said, not all of them, but majority of them. So I said, you know, you have a South Indian heritage, looks like, you know. So now this is SST Q omega, and you have two equations, K and omega, and again you are calculating nu t from K and omega. They are all there. Now this is the model that we have developed, and my student, you know, this Tim Ray developed it. Now I have put this thing here. So if you go and Google it, or you can just plug it in the browser, then you will find that some of the top-notch models, including SA model, SSTK omega model, in NASA. This is a NASA website. You cannot fiddle around with it. You cannot add to it, and you cannot subtract from it. And they are very, very careful in accepting a model and putting on the website, because that it is used worldwide. And they have test cases that, which are called benchmark cases, that you, if you have developed anything or anything you have done, you have to prove that you can do it. And they give you everything so that there is no error. So they will give you the geometry, they will give you the grid, they will give you the boundary condition. The only thing variable is the turbulence model. So then you can take all that simple configuration and see if you have done something with a new turbulence model or new idea that you have developed. And it will, once you have that and you talk to them and you have proven them by doing about at least 20 to 30 cases, then they may like to discuss with you, and then it takes at least 4 to 5 years to convince, because they are very, very strict that they don't want to put in any junk on their website. Okay, you can find a lot of junk on Wikipedia, but this is the website which is the most credible, used by the turbulence modelers all over the world. So you can see that this is a website at Langley Research Center at NASA.gov. So if you go over it, you will see that. So now we developed this model, the Agarwal model, in 2015. So this year we have, so they put in a bracket, you know, 2015 or 16. And you have to have a published paper with all the test cases to prove, so people know what was done. And after that, they have their own code, which is a government code. You have to, they will give you a little money to implement it and show that it works. You just cannot say, sir, it works. You have to prove in their software that it works. And then they may accept it to put it in. And then if you improve it, then they have what they call 2015, 2017, 2018. So we have distance-free model, that is a 2018 version that will be put in, you know, maybe in next few months. The guy who is in charge, you know, is very busy actually, that's why he's not able to do it. So now if you go over this, I'm not going over detail. Now we have this R, which is equal to K over omega, which is nothing but mu t. And so you have now again one equation. So you can see that how much complication is there, which takes this equation from k omega to k epsilon in the free stream. So it is a very creative thought that has gone into it. All right. So I actually want to acknowledge, you know, that the student who was involved with was a very creative as well. So now this is the final version of the model. So this is k over omega, and all these constants are there. So again, my advice is that if you are interested, we will make you the UDF that you can put in any of these codes, but don't play around too much with the constants until you are very sure that what is happening. But these constants have been fine-tuned with a lot of work and a lot of effort. So this is now the wall distance free version that is coming out in 2018. And this basically follows the same logic that is for the Spallard-Elmhurst model. So it doesn't have a D. So this is the old version, has this D guy sitting here. That is the distance. But the new version, all the D is eliminated. So it works very well for a shear layer flow. So now you can improve it. You know, these are some other improvements that I am mentioning, but that is not relevant. So once you have this model, that you have to prove that it works. So then you have number of extension you can do. That was the incompressible flow, so that you can put the compressibility correction. For a compressible flow, that works for transonic and high speed. Then there is other thing that if you have a recirculating flow with lot of eddies, like in a flow in a rectangular channel or flow in a curved pipe, then you are, what is you call is a QCR, means quadratic constitutive relation, which means that stress is no longer proportional to the strain, but the stress is proportional to strain plus the square of the strain. So that is why it's called the quadratic constitutive relation, that it improves the capture of the secondary vortices. So these are the compressibility correction. Then you can have higher order, higher temperature correction that becomes into play in a very high speed flow, like a space shuttle, for example. Then the temperature is so high that you have to do the correction. Now the other one is a rotation and curvature correction. Okay. It was originally developed by Spalhart and Schur. So if you have a very curved pipe, or like, you know, somebody showed me that cyclone, these models require some correction. So this is what you do. Now of course, if it is not a smooth boundary, it's a rough wall, or like wind turbine. Wind turbine is always rough, because all these bugs are floating around, you know, and they get stuck. So it is always rough. So then you have to put a rough. And then as I told you that based on the four equation SSP, RE theta T gamma model, you can reduce it to two equations. So one equation for WA, the other equation for the intermittency. Intermittency is the one that captures the transition. So now there are other versions, and that which means that in some cases it is good to combine the LES plus RANS. So in certain part of the flow, you can use large eddy simulation, and the other part of the flow you can use the Reynolds averaged, and that is called the detached eddy simulation, the two together. So that makes it very complicated and lot more expensive. Okay, but in a large eddy simulation, you have to do a three-dimensional problem. You cannot do a two-dimensional problem. Okay, it is like talking about two-dimensional turbulence. Okay, it works sometimes, but it is just coincidence. So people have done the two-dimensional large eddy simulation, but it's just a fluke. So to be theoretically rigorous, you have to have a three-dimensional flow, which means that it is very compute intensive, and the resolution of the small scale eddies, you know, require a lot of work. So without going into that too much detail, we have extended it to the detached eddy simulation and the implicit delayed detached eddy simulation. Okay, so they have advantages for some complicated cases. So now I'm basically focusing on the WA model actually. So you see that how much more functions and complications are there. Okay, so this is all published in the literature, but that is not the essence of this talk actually. So now the thing is that what it can do for you in terms of the real calculation, and how does it impact what you're after. So the flows which are complicated, but also in the context of the flows that have jets, and that is required for the case of the flow control. So as I said that this has already been implemented. So this is the website. It is implemented. How many of you have heard of OpenFOAM? Okay, there are at least few people. OpenFOAM is free. And if you have a good version of OpenFOAM, then you can modify yourself, because it is a source code. Okay, so that is a big advantage. But it's still, you know, I mean, implementation of anything, you know, it requires effort. But this is also available from us free, actually, if you want to use this module in the OpenFOAM. Okay, Now, there is a UDF for Fluent that we have made it available to a lot of people around the world, actually. And then this is the NASA code that was required for the code to go onto the website. So it has been implemented in this NASA code, which is actually a proprietary code. It's not available. And so, as I told you, some of the institutions that it has already been used in China, and now it has actually recently been also asked for, which is not updated yet, in people in Italy and so on. Okay, this is all available. And you can, you know, send me an email, but I like to talk in person actually. So use your WhatsApp. So this is the validation. So if you go on a NASA website, then these are the cases, benchmark cases, that they give you a grade, they give you the boundary condition, and they have you, they have results for SA and SST models. So it is all available. And these are very well defined cases. And so if you are interested, you know, there is a work there for, you know, next 10 years for too many PhD theses, you know. All right? So what I'm showing you here is that these green ticks are the ones that we had to calculate to prove that it is a good model. Okay? So this is one set of cases. And this is the other set of cases, again from NASA, and where they are primarily more internal flow and complex cases with a higher transonic and supersonic Mach number. And again, from this, we did this cases here. So these are actually in total of about 30 cases. But then we did additional 15 cases, which are not listed. So this is the kind of things that one has to go through to, in case of turbulence modeling, to see whether it works from a fundamental point of view. So I will show you some results here. So this is a mixing layer. So we wanted to see that if you don't have a distance, then how does that mixing layer, which is very difficult to calculate by the Spallard model, SST K omega model, and how does our model, so our VR is WA. This is the SA model and this is STK omega. This is the experiment. You have to always validate against the experiment. Grid, boundary condition, geometry, everything is identical, as I said. They are given. You don't have to think about it. Okay, the only thing is calculate it properly with a good convergence. So you see far wake behind a cylinder, plane jet, round jet, radial jet, all mixing layer, and you can see the spreading rate. Okay. So this is the experiment, okay, with some small bands or bounds. And then if you go over it, you will find that our model is doing better than many other models. Okay? So it is a proof that it works. I mean, I don't want to go over each number, you have it in your book. So now this is a backward facing step, again a standard case. This is a grid given by NASA actually. So what you have is the reattachment length because the flow separates. And I showed you one case for a flow control, you know, yesterday or day before. So what you can see here is, again, this is the data. And so this is the red line. And this is separation. So you see the red line is doing better than the green and the blue. So blue is SA, green is SST, and this is the red line. At half the cost, you are getting a better result on everything the same. Okay? And this is the pressure distribution. Again, you can see the difference between the three set of models. Now, this is another test case with a diffuser. Alright? And again, you have a skin friction, which is a very difficult quantity to compute. So you see red, blue, and so the SST, which is similar to the WA model, it does very close. So we call it competitive, but half the cost. SA model really doesn't do a good job, which is the one equation model. Okay? So I know these guys, all of them personally, you know. So when I talk to them, I never say your model is bad, you know. Otherwise, you know, I mean, you will create animosity. Okay? I only say that my model is okay, look at it. I never say that, so there is no point in saying that you are not a good person, right? But you can say, I am okay, you know, I'm a good person, that's it. Instead of saying you are a bad person, you can say, I'm a good person, without saying the other person is being a bad person. Okay, keep everybody happy, you know. That is the way you can increase the happiness in the world, actually. Now, this is the one that is one of the most famous cases. It's called the NASA Wall Mounted Hump. And if you remember, you know, I spent a lot of time, you know, in previous lectures. And why it is important is because there is a separation here. And the goal is to capture this separation correctly. It has been a very, very hard problem, you know. And it's still not totally resolved by all the models. And so you have a separation, you see how much grid is there to resolve that. Okay. And what you see here, this is data and this is pressure distribution. None of the model captures this little hump. So that is where this hybrid DES come into play, and I will show you that it really takes care of it. But none of the model WA, SST and SA really do a good job. Now this is, what is this is here? This DES, WA and SA model, okay? And again you can see that in certain part of it does a better job, but nothing perfect. So this is our LES and WA model together. Now this is the skin friction, which is an even more difficult quantity. And what you see here is that all these turbulence models don't do a good job. So here it appears that, you know, SA is doing better, but if you look at in the separation part of the hump, okay, none of them is doing a good job. But if you add the LES into it, and that is becomes a DES version of it, you see that this almost captures the whole data. So it is a level of improvement that you have to keep on considering depending on the problem. The model is not frozen to work for all the problems. So you can keep on developing, you know, as needed. Okay, so now we looked at based on our DES work that I showed you, and then it so happens that we completely fix the whole problem. So now it is a perfect result with the data. And this data, this result was published for the first time, and that was the most exciting that thing that people from NASA, you know, got excited. And you saw that, you know, in the case of the sweeping jets, you saw this name of the video, you know, that was Vozdilo. Boeing company. It did this experiment again and worked with us in the CFD, and you can see that CFD and experiment are almost on top of each other. So this is the turbulence modeling effort that you require to go step by step. Now this is again a tough problem because you have a NACA 4412. I think there was somebody who told me that they are working with 4412. I don't know who the person was. Is anybody mentioned to me? May not be here, but somebody was working with 442. So in this case, it is the angle of attack is 14 degrees. So there is a separation at the trailing edge. So it's a very tough case. And so what happens is that the separation region, which is a blown up region shown here, none of the model can capture it. So here you see that compared to SA, the only model that are able to capture the separation at the rear end of the aerofoil is the WADES and WA model. So there must be something good about the model. So now this is another benchmark test case of the separated boundary layer over a hump. But this is a cylindrical hump. The other one was a two-dimensional hump. So now again you can see the various models. So WA is here, that is the data for the skin friction. This is red line, and here is again the red line. So you can see that one equation SA model doesn't do a good job. So what has happened is that as a result of the results that I am showing you, these people in, you know, like who are basically the managers of turbulence modeling in ANSYS Fluent, they are really now concerned that whether they should consider some other model. SSTK omega is working reasonably well, but it is double the cost. So I think it will take some time, but I think that SA model will eventually get replaced unless until some improvements are made to it. But not right now, because right now, you know, people around the world, you know, maybe at least 10,000 plus people are using it all over the world. So now this is a very tough case, because there is a very huge separation here, and in this case, as you will see with respect to the data, none of the model actually does a good job. But there are some small improvement if you use the WADES model. But SA model is again very bad. You see this green, and of course if you go into the details of the velocity profile in capturing the separation, the SA model really doesn't do a good job at all. Now this is the one that is the S duct. Okay. So you know, Dr. Jain, you know, his some colleague, and I think Dr. Paul and some student, they are doing this S duct, or this is called a serpentine duct. Okay. Now this duct is very important in case of fighter aircraft, because you have very small space and you have to take the flow and go to the engine phase in a very small way. So you can put a pipe. For pressure recovery you have to have some kind of a serpentine duct to make it possible. But as soon as you have a curvature, you have a separation. Because what does curvature do physically? How do you create a separation, by the way? We talked about it quite at length. Adverse pressure gradient. So the curvature is a, who said that? The smart guy over there, right? So that is a must. Without adverse pressure gradient, if the pressure is positive, you will keep on flowing. So only when the pressure for some reason is forced to be against the flow, then it will separate. So this is the curvature that makes it possible. So what you really want is, this is the interface plane with the engine. So what you want is that at the interface plane your pressure recovery is good. So what does the separation do if there is separation? It reduces the pressure recovery. So this is a very good problem for flow control. And I'm going to show the results of flow control, not today, but maybe tomorrow, but certainly before I leave. Okay. So this is a very, very fundamental, very good problem for flow control. So now how will you control it? You can do it. You can do passive flow control by using the vanes, micro ramp, vortex generator, and synthetic jet. Okay, don't use the sweeping jet. Why not? You don't need it. For a mild separation, you know, why you want to use a sweeping jet? So always use the technology that is simple, cheap, easy, but has enough control authority to do the job. So in this case, actually the vanes and our micro ramp works very well, but you can combine with this synthetic jet, and I will show you some results actually, because the separation is mild actually. But if you have a very, very curved serpentine duct, then separation is more, but it is not as bad that you will require a big. These ducts are small, curvature is such that it can work. But again, synthetic jets have been a very big disappointment actually. It's too much. Too little control authority, because that piezoelectric diaphragm doesn't work, and if you have very high frequency, you know, you cannot build it. So now you see here, this is a very interesting result. So what you see here is, this is the data, and this is SA, green. Look at how bad it is. Then you have WA, yellow, and WADES, that is combined with LES, is again red. So these are the kind of results, if you can show, it means that you have developed something interesting, useful. Okay. But again, I will emphasize that it requires a different kind of creative thinking to look at these terms in the model, and which means that what is the implication of kinetic energy? What is the implication of dissipation of turbulent eddies? What is the implication of pseudo-vorticity? And how does they affect, in terms of the magnitude, to affect the eddy viscosity of the flow? So now this is other one, which is a transonic flow. And this transonic flow, again, you have seen a number of models. This is a green, and this is a red. None of them is perfect. In this case, there is a short interaction. So this problem is, flow is separated because of shock boundary interaction. You need to improve it. So this remains again a really difficult problem to handle. But there is a progress. If you look at it, this is a red portion, and you see this red line follows most of the area except this part. So it is doing better than actually at least this SA, which is here, misses the point here. So the I am telling you is going to be, you know, in a difficulty, you know, in a few years to come. Now this is a completely high speed flow. So the jet that is coming out, this is the jet, which is at a high Mach number of, I think, 3. So the flow is sucked in as an entrainment and mixes inside this chamber, so it is like ejector. So if you remember that, you know, yesterday or day before, I showed the ejector. But that was a low speed ejector. And what we did is we pulsed the flow here as an example of flow control. So air is basically a result, and you see the difference. This is the SA model. And this is SSTQ omega. And the red one is the WA model. Okay. So this, everything is the same. Grid, boundary condition, geometry, everything same. You see how bad the result is. How terrible the SA model result is. Okay. So this is the kind, you see here again, velocity profile is some section. So this is the kind of work you need to do in turbulence modeling, and this becomes even worse if you have flow control. Now this is the one that I was telling you, that you have a situation that you have a rectangular duct and a supersonic flow at high speed is going inside the duct. This is the same case in a curved tube. So you have these secondary flow vortices that develop. This is a very, very tough case for the modeling. So what you see here, this is the data. This is data. And you see that if you use the WA model, without this higher order correction, which is called the quadratic constitutive relations, with a nonlinear model for the stress versus the strain, you cannot capture it. So even WA model doesn't work. So it is nothing like a universality there. I mean, you have to see what happens. So now, so this is just a single slide, but the if you have a plain WA model, you get this. No secondary vorticity or secondary flow is captured. But here, if you use this QCR, you get a right answer completely. Okay? So it means that you have to go further than the standard implementation. Now, this is something that was not on the NASA requirement for this, and this is the rotation and curvature cases. Now, this is a lot of flows have curvature. Lot of them. And lot of them are rotation, like a cyclone, for example. So that becomes very difficult. So it requires actually an even different level of ingenuity to do this. I'll not go into this, but you can extend. And so to do that, there is another theoretical construct that you have to bring in, that is called uncertainty quantification. I don't know anybody has heard of that. So which creates another level of optimization of these constants. So creates a little more difficulty. But it turns out that there are other constants that you have to bring in. So this is the original model, and this is the modified model based on the uncertainty quantification. And I will not go into the theory. But then we did about these 10 cases. to prove it works. One case will not do it. So a total of close to 50 cases were done to validate all this. Okay? So you need at least, you know, 5 graduate students to do this, assigning everybody 10. The only control that you have on them is that you will not get a PhD unless you finish it. I'm just kidding, you know. But I'm saying that once you get into this, then you have all the other machinery, you have the boundary condition, you have the grade and everything, and then you can see what happens actually. It's not that bad. So you see, this is a curved duct, this is a U-tube, this is a rotating channel, rotating backward facing step, rotating cavity, serpentine channel, these are all benchmark cases, and the hydrocyclone is there, one of them. And then of course, jet in cross flow, supersonic and subsonic. So now you see here, I'm going to show only a couple of cases, you know, which are the most difficult ones. So this is a rotating serpentine channel which has too much curvature, and along with that is rotating also. In about the axis, which is perpendicular to this screen, okay, and there are the stations at which the experiment was done, and the other models were used, station 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. There are two bends, one curvature here, another curvature there, and it is rotating. So every complication that you can name it is there. So I'm just showing you because we don't have time to go over it to show that, but so there is a rotation number, there is a Reynolds number, and this is the final result for some of the cases. So what you see here, I mean, there's a, you may not decipher everything in the slide, but which line is the best? The black line. Okay? It is, in some cases, blue line is better. See this black line here, black line here, black line here, black line here. It's not a perfection, but it's better than others. Otherwise, everything is all over the map. It was a very, very tough case. So what it proves is that you can get with the data as good as is possible for such a complicated rotation and curvature. Again, I am, you know, basically trying to sell it. But it is the black line, which is the WA model with the RC correction. By developing the coefficient using the uncertainty quantification theory. So you see how many steps are there. So this is again the rotating serpentine channel. This is a black curve, and you see here the black curve is really bad. Here black curve, or every curve is bad. But overall, if you look at all the 8 stations, you know, this is the best you can do. Okay, so now the roughness. You can put in the roughness for like wind turbines and other cases. And so you can see here that this is WA model, this is SA model, this is STK omega model, this is the data, and this is the wind turbine aerofoil SA29, and which is rough. Okay. So this is the shape of the turbine aerofoil, which is thick. Wind turbine aerofoils are much, much thicker than the transport. You know why? Why they are thick? It's a very simple reason actually. Because the wind turbine face storms all the time. And the wind variability is so large, and you don't want, you know, that half of the blade is sheared off and, you know, go somewhere, which is not the case for the transport aeroplane. But that's not the only reason. What about the Reynolds number? Is much lower than the Reynolds number for a transport aeroplane. I told you, what is it? 30 to 40 million. What is for a wind turbine? How much? This is not 10.5 is very high. At the tip it could be higher, but it is the order of 3 to 4 million. And why is it so small? Because the speed is low. I mean, you cannot have a speed, you know, at a 400 miles an hour, like a plane, right? If you could have it, you know, we'll be energy free, you know. But then we all will be flying in into the air, actually. So it's a good luck that it's not that high. Okay. By the way, if you ever run into a storm, and if you want to save yourself, even in a tornado, what will you do? What is the best solution based on your fluid mechanics? Suppose you run into a real storm and there is a tornado coming. I mean, even the trees can be gone. What is the, you may not survive, but I mean, what is the best thing you can do to survive? Based on fluid mechanics. Center where? Center of where? You know the center of the storm? My goodness, that is the, you are a really great meteorologist. If you know the center of the storm, right? And if you want to go to the center of the storm, you will be churning like a milkshake, you know. Just think about simple fluid mechanics. That's a good answer. Yeah, that's a good answer. I think you are thinking in the right direction. But the simplest answer is just lie down a pancake. No, just lie down a pancake and sleep and hope for the best, or maybe pray. Because you are in the boundary layer, and whatever the speed, the boundary layer, it has to go to zero. Okay, and if you are physically fit and don't have too much of a stomach, you will be even better. Right? So that is the easiest thing. The reason that the trees, they have a problem, because they are standing. They unfortunately cannot lie down. So it is simple fluid mechanics. If you remember, you can save yourself actually. So these are important points. What you have is, in this case, tell me why this is like this. What is this? You see, this is the CL versus alpha. How many of you have taken aerodynamics? 3 or 4. So the people who have taken aerodynamics, if you have an aerofoil, is stalling. So what is the linear part? That comes from the basic aerodynamics. So CL is equal to how much time alpha? Anybody remembers? CL is equal to 2 pi alpha. You should remember by heart. So the irony is that solution CL over 2 pi alpha, CL is equal to 2 pi alpha, comes from the simple potential theory. No code. It was developed in 1910, right? But the assumption is that the aerofoil is very thin, angle of attack is very small, mathematically. But it works for angle of attack up to 15 to 18 degrees, and it works for aerofoil 20% thick. And in the if you measure this slope, flat slope is 2 pi alpha. Okay, so it is perfect. So when I give a question to my students and I say, hey, you know, this is the aerofoil, give a shape. My goodness, it's rough, it's tough. I say, I just want a lift, no drag. Your grade point will develop, I will give you grade perfect 100% as quickly as giving the answer. And you have these tools, no book, nothing, tell me the answer, right away you get 100. If you go to Navier-Stokes, You will get a wrong answer, I'll give you 5. You will go and put the grade, put the geometry, tell the calculation, and you still will be wrong. So always approach the problem in the simplest manner. That's the bottom line. So CL is 2 pi alpha, and this is a stall. So in this case, it is rough, so it is about 12 degrees for a fat aerofoil. If you go on a basic book by Anderson, you can show that the NACA 0012 aerofoil, the CL is 2 pi alpha for a 12% thick aerofoil up to angle of attack over 16 degrees. And after that, the flow is stalled. This is a flow control problem because you have to remove this stall and go all the way. So instead of going this, what is the objective of flow control? You keep on going straight. You can keep on going straight as much as possible. So one of the presentation I will show you, maybe tomorrow, is that it is possible by putting the flow control like a synthetic jet. It is not possible to do it by a vortex generator. Otherwise, if the vortex generator could have done it, we would have solved this stall problem long time ago. So it's every solution doesn't work, that is the bottom line. So in this case you need a jet. But don't use a sweeping jet. Too much complication for very little benefit. So there is not a single solution for everything, you know. Now here you see that, again of course I'm comparing here, the goal is SA rough here, WA rough here, SSTQ omega here. So again the WA, you know, is competitive with SST, and there is an experiment there. Now this is a transition model I was telling you, and you know, this was done by another student of mine, Jacob Nagapetian, and this will be go on NASA website in about a year or so. So here this is the original equation, and this is the gamma or intermittency equation. So now 4 equations have been reduced into 2. So again it requires a lot of creativity, what to throw, what not to throw, how to change the coefficients, how to change all these functions. So there's a lot of stuff there that goes into creativity. So this is the results. So you see the beauty here, these are the standard benchmark cases. SSTK omega, transition 4 equations, experiment, and this is our 2 equation. So you see that if you remember, you know, in any textbook, this is the transition part. So the flow comes laminar, becomes transition fully turbulent. Flow becomes laminar, his transition, this guy, and this. Flow becomes laminar here, transition turbulent. Okay. You may not remember about this, but for a pipe flow, you have seen the Moody diagram. How many of you seen the Moody diagram? The same thing. For a pipe flow, flow is initially laminar, go through transition turbulent. This is a flat plate. Any basic book in fluid mechanics has these results. Now what do you see here? This is blue, that is SST. Which is the best line? That is this, our 2 equation model. But this is actually really prominent in this case, a second case with this kind of parameters. You see this dip of transition is completely missed by the SST omega model. You know, so if you are a mentor who is a developer of all these things, you are going to hate me, right? So how do you make friend out of a person who hates you? How do you make a friend out of a person who hates you? It's a social science problem, you know, not a fluid mechanics problem. Okay. Never butter him up. Okay, that is means you are weak. Just socialize, maybe take them for a drink, a nice dinner, you know, and try to say that, you know, we are friends, but there are other solutions in the life, you know, it's not the end, that's what you have done, you know, and it works actually. So he is seriously considering to see whether there is a merit. But there is a resistance, you know. You always like what you have done, you know, so it takes time. So now it shows again the data. See, data, results. So these are basically no comparison with anybody else but our own results. And you see how beautifully they are matching with the turbulence intensity with the Reynolds number on the plate. Right? Now these are the more details of the velocity profiles. Again, these are only our calculations with the data. So our is a blue, data is a red. Now this is a more difficult case of a aerofoil, which is a French aerofoil, and again SSC transition, WA, and you see the CD, and you see the experiment, and you see the CL. So this is the final result. So there is not too much difference, but you see this is the SSC transition, and this is the 4 equation, this is the 2 equation. So I think that basically there is a lot of work actually. If you want, there are a lot of papers, there are about tons and tons of cases there, and I have tried to actually focus primarily on the 1 equation models and 2 equation models, because beyond that I think it's too expensive, too complicated, and then I will show you some results for flow control. It seems they do work, but they don't work always, but most of the time they do. And of course this is the summary. But what is the future actually? So the future is that now we have techniques to optimize these coefficients, and that is called the technique of uncertainty quantification. That is a new wave. And then of course we need more experiments, but also you can automatize this process by using some tools of machine learning and artificial intelligence, so you don't have to do work too hard. And then of course there are other ideas, you know, that you can explore, you know, it's not the end of it, you know. So you can see that since the time of Prandtl, it has been more than 100 years, and the subject is very, very slowly developing. And the reason is that to make a fundamental advance in this field, it requires enormous patience, enormous amount of deeper thinking, and with the understanding that it may lead to nothing. Okay. But if you are willing to take that risk and you succeed, then the fruit of the outcome is going to be really very sweet. Okay. So I think that we will close it here, and tomorrow I will come back to the examples of flow control and more complicated cases of separation, and see, you know, how well these models work, including the S duct and the flow or aerofoil with separation, etc. Okay. Yeah, as I said, I will show you tomorrow. You see, tomorrow, I depend on how I'm going to structure it. We have 4 more lectures. So there is one case in which there is a massive separation on the, you know that flow stalls. How you can control that? So like if you have a multi-element aerofoil, that is a high lift. The flap can cause a lot of separation, which means reduce the lift. How do you, first of all, what kind of actuator you can use? Synthetic jet. I will show you that if you use a passive device, it doesn't work. Because where are you going to put the passive device, and it can actually mess up the whole thing. So you have some kind of a jet. You don't have to use synthetic jet, you can use a uniform jet. You can use an oscillatory jet. So the main idea is to create vortices that can, the main fundamental idea of fluidic actuator is what? to create vortices that can create momentum, momentum can energize the flow, and energization of the flow can force the boundary layer to remain attached physically. So that is one case I will show. And then that will show, you know, which model will work. But again, you know, it turns out that the final result is mixed. But SA model is not good. That much I can tell you. Now, between the WA model and SST, K omega model, etc., you know, there is not much to, you know, think too much. But on the other end, you know, is half the price with same result or better. For transition, it is actually more effective. And I will show you the case of S duct, where there is separation. That is where the ramp, the vanes, the synthetic jet, they all can work. So it's a very different thing. So depends on what the flow is. So I'll show you some of these cases, and then that will also always involve some turbulence modeling. But if you want a summary right now, then summary is a WA model is better. Okay. Now the only problem I have when I say that, I am very kind of feel funny inside, because you guys may be thinking this guy is a salesman, you know, selling his model. But this is the truth. They put in tremendous amount of effort to do these 50 cases with a lot of deep thinking, with a lot of, you know, these things are some, these students are really brilliant actually, who did it. The one who did deep thinking and who put in the effort and who put it together. But you know, the outcome has been that they are doing very well. They have been recognized, they are having good jobs, they have a good future. And fortunately, it didn't happen that, you know, my good friend long time ago, that he quit fluid mechanics forever. So they're still there, and they're happy. And they, at such a young age, they have their name on like places like NASA websites, and people are using their work. If you can write hundreds of papers and nobody knows that you have done anything, because they are worth not that impact. So the impact of the work is the one that is more important, even if it is only one paper. You know, if you came up with the idea of a laser or Raman spectroscopy, you can get a Nobel Prize, right? Okay, or you can have all kind of measurements. It's okay. Everything has a value. So in terms of the impact of the work, you know, this kind of work has a lot more impact. So that is what I'm saying is, and the impact is felt after a long, long time. You have to continuously let people try, improve it. So that is why I have told people that whatever we have done is free. And take it, and we will even help you in implementation. You know, the moment I say that I am going to charge, you know, 100 rupees, you know, nobody will even come closer to me, right? As a matter of fact, I am willing to actually take a person to feed him a dinner if he wants to implement it. How many of you want to do that? There is one person at the corner, you know, right? No ladies are ready actually, right? But I am telling you seriously that it is difficult to convince people, you know. But it will happen. If a technology is good, it will happen. And I think it's already happening. So I will show you some results tomorrow and day after, you know, because now I will have more focus completely on the control, come back to it. Okay? All right.